First part, I'm going to give us a brief overview of the whole fort so that you will better understand the conservation project that I'm going to present. You can understand the context in which those projects were carried out. So, we all know that what is located in the southern tip of the island, and we can see the sort of area view of the wall. You can see that it's a 45 cd, very heavy grid with the entire core structure. You can see the sort of location of the bastions and the rampart. Bastions are located at very strategic point in order to defend the attack from the land side as well as from the sea side. When we look at the sort of land use plan of the whole fort, we can see that there are buildings belonging to different period of the history. Originally, most of the buildings are sort of constructed during the occupation of the Dutch, but later on it has been modified and altered during the occupation of the British as well as in the post-independent era. You can see that there are very few Dutch buildings intact. Both buildings are in yellow color, are original Dutch buildings which are still intact. But all other buildings, although they were constructed during the occupation of the Dutch, it has been altered and modified due to the occupation of the British as well as in the post-independent era. You can see the buildings which are in yellow are the Dutch buildings. Then you can see some sort of other period buildings as well. You can see that in 1998, the world has been declared as a World Heritage City by UNESCO, understanding its universal value. Then the Rwanda city has a universal value, it has been declared as a World Heritage Monument by UNESCO, because these values are sort of a common to entire mankind. That's why it's called universal right. It's not the these values are not confined to a particular context or a particular country. It's a value highly appreciated by the entire world community, entire global community. That's why it has become a world identity, identifying its universal values. So, as far as conservation efforts of the goal sort of is concerned, the goal identity foundation was established in 1994 in order to preserve and conserve this historic city. Because we know that the values of the city must be preserved. As far as the values are concerned, values can be sort of categorized into two main areas, tangible values as well as intangible values. If we preserve only tangible values, we preserve only the area of the building. But we have to preserve the social culture and context as well, which is the intangible culture of this historic city. So because we know that a lot of houses have been converted into guest houses, then we want to be able to sort of conserve the social culture context which produce these structures. So unless we conserve the sort of social culture context and the community there, we won't be able to conserve the intangible aspect of the heritage. If you can conserve the physical buildings, it may not be the right conservation. We only sort of conserve the physical fabric of the city. But we have to see the underlying social culture context, which is the intangible, that is more important than the physical fabric of the city. Then we look at the land use pattern. You can see the yellow buildings, which are basically residential buildings. Originally, most of the buildings are situated back later on. Some of the buildings have been converted to commercial and guest houses and some commercial uses. So that's what I am saying, that foreigners started buying land there and converting some residential houses into guest houses so that community will be sort of taken out from the fort. So that's why we won't be able to conserve the social culture context which has been there for over centuries. So that's why it's very important that we must have some guidelines in order to ensure that community will be there sustaining the social culture context which has been existed for centuries. You can see that it's, the total area of the fort is 38 hectares in the Ramparts fort, 40% owned by the state organization. You can see some patches of open spaces here and there, which accounts for 10% of the total land area of the fort. And also, we can see originally 80% of the area of the historic old fort were houses, but it has now been reduced to 35%. So if this trend continues, there won't be any houses sort of left, so that the entire fort will be converted to commercial area, so that we won't be able to conserve the intangible culture which I mentioned earlier. So we are conserving on the physical fabric without sort of conserving its real tangible and intangible aspect both. as far as the conservation is concerned, what is conservation? Conservation is a sort of action that we take to prolong the life of the historic building. So we have to understand the values of the building. So that's called value-based conservation. So first, before approaching the conservation, we have to analyze the values, tangible values as well as intangible values. Then only we have to take decision how we are going to conserve those values. So historic building is like a book. Book has a sort of chapters, like historic building has period. If you read a historic building very carefully, it also tells you a story, like a book. Book tells you a story, book has sort of a different chapters will give you a different context. Because if you read the building properly, you can get the ideas of the people living in that particular period. Because it has period, not like a book, it has chapters. So if you read the historic building properly, like reading a book, so you will understand the culture, the context of the people who are living at the time of creation of this fort. How these values have been evolved throughout the history. Like if you read very carefully, the building tells you the entire story of how it was created. The culture of the people who created their values, their beliefs, all that will be understood if you read the building properly. So that's why it's very important to read the historic building very carefully so that you will get a lot of information with regard to the historic period and the context and the beliefs and the customs which are prevailed during the sort of periods of the history. And we have to understand the values of the monument. So as far as values are concerned, we can say architectural values, aesthetic values, historical values, and documentary, archaeological, economic value, social, political, all that value must be analyzed so that your construction decision must be value-based. So you have to decide what which values are important. So then your decision must be based on then you prioritize the values. So that is called sort of value-based approach for conservation. So I would like to first present my first project, which is the conservation of the Dutch warehouse. Dutch Reformed Church, conservation of Dutch Reformed Church. I would like to, before I come to the conservation of Dutch Reformed Church, so we must mention why we conserve this project, because there was a proposal by the government of Netherlands to promote the cultural tourism in the southern region. Basically, in the region, we have three districts for gold, marker, and Hemantha. Because we decided to conserve all the monuments in these three districts to encourage the cultural tourism. Because ultimately, the objective is to raise the living standard of the people who are living there. They said that the basis of the cultural tourism should go to the bottomless layer of the society. So that was the idea of the project, in order to raise the living standard of people living in those societies. Because when we look at the tourism, the benefit will be enjoyed only by the top layer of the society. But another company stressed and insisted that the benefit must go to the bottommost layer so that sustaining their living patterns and raising their living standard. So that's why we undertook those conservation projects under the kind assistance of the government of Netherlands. So these, there are 14 projects in this three district implemented under the assistance of the government of Netherlands, because we know that the gold is a heritage, it is a mutual heritage, because we call it heritage of poor parentage, because we see heritage belong to Sri Lanka as well as to the Netherlands, that's why it's mutual heritage, so that Dutch also values the all the monuments constructed in the equation, so they came forward to assist the conservation board project in order to ensure this project will be sort of done in a successful manner, conserving the heritage values. So, first I will present the conservation of the Dutch Reformed Church under the assistance of the Dutch. This is the status at the time of we undertook the best portion of the Dutch Reformed Church. The project cost was 15 million. This is also a very interesting story that I would like to share with you. Because when we were sort of start exploring this building, there were no this carving was not available. There are four doors as us. All carving was missing. It was removed by the Dutch. So we were wondering how to sort of reproduce those carving without knowing the exact details. Then I came to my mind that we had an exhibition in Goa, photographic exhibition in the Hemantha desert. So when I was going through those photographs, for the space and photographic exhibition, I got a very tiny image of this carving. So when I was trying to sort of expand the carving and document the details of the carving, I got a call from the Church office in Bangalore. So they told me, so I have this term, they have something interesting to show you. I was wondering what it was. But I went to their office. So when I went there, when I sit in front of that, everyone said that I will show you something interesting. So he opened his program, put something on the board, on the table. I was surprised not that it was the scar. So I was wondering how they got it. So I asked them, how did you get it? So they told me that when they were traveling from the goal, they went into a sort of antique shop in Nikon. They suddenly saw this scar displayed at this antique shop in Nikon. So they could have taken this memo to the police, but they didn't do that. They asked how they got it. They said that they purchased it from some, you know, it was a traffic, they purchased it. But they said that we can give it to you, give me the price that I gave to that person. I don't want any credit for this. But then that even the Dutch government would have taken that payroll to the police and got it sort of confiscated, but they didn't do it because they didn't have time to go to the police and things like that. But they, because they gave the new sum and got these sort of carving back. So that I was able to do the four carving based on the sample that I have got and the fix all four carvings in photo processes which I will work for. This is also important because this molding was completely detached. It was on the verge of falling when you undertook the restoration. So it is a very elaborately sort of carved molding. But today, in the restoration, one of the problems is that we don't have sort of craftsmen who are specialized in doing this sort of carving. That is one of the problems. Unless we do the training and the capacity building of the craftsmen, we won't be able to undertake the restoration in future. That's one of the major problems that I was facing during the transmission of this reform church. You know, the experienced craftsmen are the one of the major problems that we are facing. Because no craftsman can do this sort of elaborate farming. So that we decided to put it back, we inserted the stainless steel rod through which, sort of, so that we were able to fix that in place, preserving sort of this carving, otherwise, we would have to redo it. It would have been very cumbersome because we don't have the expertise required in order to do such a precise carving. And this is also important because originally the church had the terracotta hexagonal tiles. But at the time of restoration, most of the terracotta hexagonal tiles were replaced with the cement hexagonal tiles because they were not able to find the terracotta sort of tiles. But they because they put the cement tiles. But when we inspect them only one, then we can see the tile is totally different. There's no terracotta tile in a very sort of a different form, but these are very prepared in unique and it's not dealt with the original terracotta tile. So we decided to use those cement tiles and put the tile which is similar to original terracotta tile. But the problem was that the tiles were not available in the market. These tiles are not available in the market. So we spoke to several tile manufacturers, but none of them, so because the country required was not much, maybe 200 or 300, but they were not interested in doing this because it was on commercial, may not be feasible or profitable. So they, most of them reduced, but we spoke to the tile corporation, but as a national venture, they undertook the sort of producing this sort of tile. But after, because the strength of the tile was very, very high, so they were not able to produce the tiles which are each have the same strength. So that was the problem, but due to two or three failures, they were able to produce for the tile. They were able to produce some tiles which are similar to somewhat similar to the strength of the original tile. So that we were able to remove all the cement tiles which were produced there material and we were put back the terracotta produced for the tile which has a similar character to that of the original. This is also important because it has a church had the stained glass. Because we didn't have the expertise of conserving stained glass. A lot of churches have 10 years or several years, 10 years time he was missing. But we were able to get the details of the, because he had the original photographs of the stained glass. So he knew what the design was. But the problem was he didn't have expertise, he didn't have know-how to do the sort of stained glass. So I think first we invited another town to support us to conserve this stained glass. But then it was they sent to an expert in the material. He sent the design there to the Netherlands. So they sent the two experts. But we first, we asked a lot of our people to join the conservation because we want to build the capacity of them. So there are a lot of judges who have taken us conservation from the private writers. So that we got the identification trained in the conservation of strain glass. So capacity building and training of the identification here is the key. Otherwise, we won't be able to undertake this excavation unless we train our younger generation concerning of strain glass. And this is the conservation of the furniture there, because this chairs has a very unique type of wheel, but there are no craftsmen who need to do that sort of wheel. So we asked several people to come, they said that we can do this sort of carving, but ultimately we could find a very old person. He said that Matya Ramna Kuhamu, so that's how the problem is. Unless we have the real sort of craftsmen, the conservation becomes very difficult. And he got a very old person. So this is the person. But we also asked several young people to join the meeting so that they also the technology will be transferred and the skills will be transferred to the next generation so that we can ensure the technology will remain and sustain. So this is the church after the restoration. We got the award from the UNESCO for this restoration under the UNESCO Heritage Asia Pacific Program for the successful restoration of the Dutch Fort Church. Now I would like to share with you another project, that is the conservation of the Dutch Vera House. You can see this is one of the longest building in Sri Lanka. So you can see the this is the archival drawing which we took from the archives of the Netherlands. And some of the roof timbers were deteriorated, but we removed all the deteriorated timber and replaced with the new timbers, it kept the same species. And this is important because these floors were originally timber. And originally these beams were Burmatic beams. And it had a timber. But during the occupation of the British, due to the difficulty of finding massive Burmatic beam, they introduced fire burners in place of massive timber beams. And instead of that timber plank floor, they introduced a concrete floor. So that there was a discussion whether to remove this concrete floor and put the original timber floor back. But we find it difficult to find these sort of massive timber beams. But in conservation, we thought that strip floor is also reflect the occupation of the British in the building. So that period also important. So that we decided to keep the this floor introduced by the British, not sort of going back to the original floor of the Dutch. But we know the design because there are six bays in this building, but one floor still had the original floor. The old Burmatic beams and the paper floor. We conserve that floor. Then you can, anybody who go there can imagine what the sort of entire floor was. This is just some photographs of the conservation of the warehouse. And also, you can see that the addition of some cement plasters. This is a lime plaster during a later period. But cement plaster and the properties of the cement plaster and the lime plaster are totally different. When we introduce a high strength material into a low strength material, what will happen is that the material which has a lower strength will deteriorate. So when you introduce cement plaster into a original lime plaster, what will happen is that the deterioration of lime plaster will be accelerated because of the pressure created by the cement plaster. So that what we decided was we remove all the cement plaster. And we strengthen the sort of is a lime plaster by injecting lime water into the soluble water. Then we apply the paintings, because there are about 13 layers. Then we analyze all the layers and we saw different colors. But we decided to have the original bottommost color of the bottommost layer, which was the color originally applied to the leading. Although there are 12 layers which we have analyzed and removed, we came to know what the original color was. In the conservation, we applied the original color of the. Then, other ones, the sort of adaptive reuse, because when we know that if the original function is no longer required, then we have to introduce some new function into this for a building. Even Colombo, the resource building, we have to introduce new function. Because that is called adaptive reuse of the historic building. When we introduce new function, it will be sympathetic to the structure of the building. It should not require any structural alteration of the building. So that's why we decided to convert this into a maritime archaeological museum. Because we were doing excavation in the Gold Bay. We have a 40, there are several shipwrecks in the Bay of Gold. So we unearthed a lot of artifacts from the excavation of the shipwreck of Abelston. So we decided to display all the artifacts in this new building when we are introducing new function of a museum into the Dutch warehouse. That is called adaptive reuse of the historic building. You can see this is original. This is all other pipes have the same originally. You can see the romantic beams and the sort of deeper flow. This was the flow entire building had originally, but at the time of creation we had only this flow, but most of the tanks were only decorated. We had to introduce new tanks, but following the same design and the same technology, we were able to introduce the new tanks and preserve this original flow. So that this is the only way that you can experience all the original flow also. And this is also a British coat of arms. Even when you enter the old fort, you can see the Dutch warehouse. Originally, the front wall of the DOC had the DOC logo, DOC Dutch logo. But during the occupation, what British did was they removed the DOC logo and put their British coat of arms in the front wall. But they didn't destroy the DOC logo, but it was they put the DOC logo in back over. So it is good that both logos are there at the moment. But it was there was a black patina in this British photos are pretty close to you over the patina, and you can see the status before and after the restoration. Yeah, this is a concern of the stakeholders. The stakeholders which were used at a later period was also deteriorated. So we decided to keep the stakeholders without reverting to the original timber beams, so that we conserve the iron girders introduced at a later period and during the situation of the British. You can see the restoration. You can see the base of the structure. This is the reflection of the deep of which I explained. This is the low of the deep translation here. You can see the reverse of this deep. This was original to in the old period, in the entire 6 case. But at the moment, only way number 6 has this original to all other process has the complete flow introduced at the original location. And this is the entrance door, which was also badly deteriorated. So you can see, because it's closer to the sea, most of the iron legs were completely deteriorated, completely corroded because of the salinity in the environment due to the pressure of the closer to the sea. And some of the tanks were deteriorated, but we decided to remove, keep all the tanks, but we introduced new timber for the part replacing the deteriorated portion only, keeping the original timber tracks, because we could remove the original impact to adjust some historical and aesthetic values. So we remove only the deteriorated part and introduce new timber, replacing only the deteriorated part, keeping the original tracks in place. You can see the conservation here also, see different layers of pain. Originally it was, in the time of construction it was cracked. When we analyze the pain layers, we came to know that original paint was the Dutch red. So we decided to apply Dutch red instead of the black color, which was there in the situation. You can see that all the deteriorated layers were removed, and we introduced new layers in the case of deteriorated layers following the same design and the same character of the layers. You can see the look after the situation. this is the EOC logo that I mentioned. It was in the front pole originally, but during the occupation of the British factory, it was removed from the front pole and fixed at the back pole. And these were originally sort of exposed beam, but later period it has been covered with several layers of sort of plaster. But it was carefully removed all the plaster layers, exposing the original brickwork. You can see the difference. This is what it was before restoration. You can see that it's covered with plaster, and you can see after the restoration. This is before, this is after. We have exposed the brickwork which have been covered in the later period, introducing some plaster. So we do all the plaster, exposed the original brickwork, and we go so far south of the EOC logo, put by the British on the back door. And you can see land, election commissioner's office, which was constructed at a later period, covering the entire facade of this core fort. We had a great fight to remove this building because there had a lot of piles are there. They don't have a place to stack those piles, so they were reluctant to move. But with the great pressure, we were able to get that sort of building removed and expose the original facade of the Dutch Pope Church. You can see the original facade, and this is how it goes. It was entirely covered. The election commissioner's office. They were refusing to move, but with the political pressure and all the sort of effort, they were able to get this building removed, exposing the original facade of the Dutch warehouse. You can see the difference. You can see the, even the, these arches were completely covered these master layers, but we removed all the rafters and we exposed the sort of original bricks, exposed brick, bricks have been exposed. We can see the building after the restoration, removing this. And after the restoration, we decided to introduce a new function called museum. I explained. This is the, we have decided to conserve this building and introduce a new function museum. This is the voice which we have done in order to introduce the new function of the museum. You can see the museum. And finally, I would like to share with you the conservation of the rampart. Rampart is one of the major features of the Galle Fort in its fortified city. Having 16 bastions locating at the strategic point of the You can see the platform of the rampart in red. You can see how the rampart goes following the river coastal line, locating bastions, a strategic point, in order to pass the attack from the land side as well as from the seaside. So before undertaking restoration, we did a very detailed digital documentation of the entire rampart. You can see the digital documentation of the rampart because there is a principle that we should not touch the monument and we document how the preserved status. Because once we restore the building, there will be a lot of old precious traditions. So we didn't know how it was originally looked like. So there is a principle that we must have a very careful documentation of the building before we undertook any restoration of any building. So you can see here, we also draw the section of the rampart at the very close intervals so that you can understand the exact profile of the rampart. When you have a number of sections, we have a thousand sections of the rampart, so we can understand the exact form and the profile of the Dutch rampart, enabling us to take right decisions with regard to the construction of the rampart. You can see the section that we have done in order to understand the profile and the topography of the rampart before undertaking the restoration. You can see the sections. This is the restoration of the rampart. We did the pointing, they have no mortar, and these stones are in the verge of paras because mortar has been washed away. So we introduced new mortar similar to the original because we analyzed the sort of ancient composition of the ancient board, which was a live mortar, not like a cement mortar. So we first task that we used to realize the chemical sort of composition. The ancient mortar we were able to develop a mortar which has similar properties and similar character to that of the original mortar. You can see the restoration here. This is how it was before restoration. When we decided to restore this, this is how after the restoration. You can see the difference between the before restoration, this is how it was. And we have the treatment and we need the careful restoration of the restoration. And even these gun bases were completely covered with there were no bases. When we did the excavation, we found these gun bases. So what we did was we conserved or exposed both the rock pieces and conserved so that you can understand the military history of the fort when you look at these rock pieces, but so that you were able to conserve all these pieces reflecting the military history of the Dutch fort. So we also got some anchors in the excavation in some of the Dutch teams. We conserved those anchors and displayed in the Hemantha part of the museum. You can see the restoration. And this is called Black Fort. This is the most ancient part of the fort built by the Portuguese. So you can see the structure of building before restoration. There are no columns over the weight, but there were column bases. And one or two columns was there. We even gave the exact form of the columns. So we were able to reproduce those columns and on the bases. So that this is the difference between. See how it was before and after. In this building where there was no roof and it was completely completed, but we were able to get the original drawings of this building from the Netherlands, so we were able to conserve this along with the original drawings of the project because we had them all the details, so that we decided to conserve along with the exact form of the original building. And this is the conservation of the back of that game. This parts were collapsed and some parts were missing. So we were able to conserve those following the same, reduce the same water. And this is something to place after exploration. This is before. And this is after. You can see the difference before exploration and after exploration. And this part of the reference was a very bad damage during the tsunami. So we decided to conserve this. You can see the difference between the before and after. So you can see that how we conserve these three projects and we were able to introduce new character to the fort, conserving all these important historic monuments, ensuring its continuity and sustainability. Thank you.
Timber, what is the timber, new timber you use?
Yeah, because we have to use the same species. Otherwise, what will happen is that in India, police are different, they will behave in a different manner. Expansion and contraction is also different. So, we must try to use the same species. In the case where the same species are not available, we have to find a timber which has similar properties to that of the original. Because we had that problem, maybe we conserve in the sort of, maybe we conserve in the Ramadeva or Rami mode. Because original timber was gone on, but it was not available. So we had to find a timber which has similar properties to that of Kamma. Because that's one of the problems that we are facing. And one is the manpower, craftsmanship, because we don't have the. Because there are a lot of families in that Ravi Mohan in Ramadeva. Only there are about 16 columns, only 8 original 8 columns were there. 8 columns have to be reproduced. So we didn't have the craftsman to have the sort of because that's why capacity and the training of craftsman is really important. Otherwise, it's the lack of timber because we don't have so much decent timber for the restoration. Otherwise, it's the species. That's what I said. Although we were trying our best to get the government, we were not able to get the government. So, that we only have the depopulation and we asked the depopulation to find the timber which has similar properties to that of Kamma. So, they said that that would be somewhat similar to the sort of Kamma so that we had to use Jack because the Kamma was not available.
The question I want to know is the Dutch, now the present Maritime Museum,
yeah.
That Dutch part of the building, what is the timber?
Yeah,
the Dutch
yes, it was Burmati.
Burmati?
Yeah, it was Burmati.
Entirely Burmati.
Yes,
so,
yes, yes.
What did you.
Yeah, we introduced tea, not Burmati, but tea was introduced.
Local tea?
Yes, yes.
Now, a lot of the contributions that were done of entering in Northeast, they brought people from India to do a lot of the carvings and all. So, I guess, I don't know whether they created capacity there. I think it's very important the fact that you have developed the capacity. So, have you got a critical mass of people now after doing the restoration?
That's the thing, that's what capacity is, because even that. the construction system also we experience the sort of this problem, lack of craftsmen. Because we don't have the trade basis or craftsmen even to the lower construction. Because the construction industry is also suffering because of the lack of manpower. Because of all the contractors are complaining that they don't have people to do them.
So
they are requesting our permission to sort of get the labor from Myanmar, maybe from Bangladesh, maybe India. Aren't they come here, they won't go there. So it will be a problem because they are requesting our approval to sort of bring the labor.
Or we should bring back our labor from the Middle East.
Yes.
I'd like to comment on that. This is also in few minutes that we had a discussion on how to do the capacity building in conservation work. So we are going to conduct several workshops to train the people in conservation work, especially class to the stone and what kind of construction, as well as the stupa construction. So in the near future, you will be listening to that.
And as well as we have to consult the ancient technologies as well. Because if there are no work cameras, or like India, people are not conversant in the Asian technologies. So we won't be able to come to construction. So that's why it's very important to train the people on the Asian technology and they have to use the Asian materials. So this is one of the key areas that we have to focus on.
About the ramparts, very heavy stone work is it was in work. So I presume that I'm not sure if it is correct. And the Dutch brought a lot of slaves from Africa, from the East Africa. Now, were those slaves, do we have evidence that they built the ramparts?
Sorry?
The ramparts were they built by African slave labor?
Yes.
Is there evidence of that?
There's no record in the Dutch. But there was a story that it was done by an African labor, but we didn't have the scientific evidence to prove it.
But I can't imagine Somali's labor doing anything.
But we use machinery in our excavation work, so there are no people who can carry these sort of boulders. So we use some machinery to place it.
No, not now.
I understand. So we didn't have the reports to prove that it was done by an African labor.
So the inside, now the other buildings also. The slave labor being used. Is that
documentation?
There's a fair amount of evidence about Colombo.
As far as I know, we didn't get any sort of proof to whom that he was done by the PGIAR.
Couple of years ago at the BMI stage, there was a stall. Specialized in stained glass windows. So I want that means there's some capacity here. If people can make stained glass windows locally, I wonder whether, of course, I don't have that telephone number or contact, but I think you can always find out. So there was a local company that was doing stained glass windows.
But the technology that they use and the Indian technology are different. But the technology that they use. And the Asian technology are different. They can't get the character of the original stained glass. Their character is different.
Yeah.
So there are some people, even at the time of when we undertook the restoration, there are some local firms. When we asked them to do that, they were not able to do it. Because their technology and their own different. So nevertheless, they brought the traditional technology. And they train other people on this technology so they can undertake the future restoration of the church. So their technology is different. They couldn't get the character of this original board.
You know, with the revolutionary technology that we asked for questions, the Sandbox judge, the stained glass window which was started by the work was restored at the University of Montpellier. So there are small pieces, but they were set together, and then the stained glass window was restored by us.
But we had the material,
yes.
But in this case, some of the panels were missing. There are no material in the case is slightly different to what we need then.
I just wanted to ask, this is a very general question, sir. Now, when you look at all this heritage conservation, what are the main challenges in this country? Because I am looking for change of disaster management, and because we have not even touched this area. because we think it's a part of a technical reason. Of course, it's a very technical matter. So what are the challenges that you will be facing in the future, today and even in the future, in terms of conservation on this historical site? Because in the next month, I think ICOMOS is having a national conference in Malaysia. Even our secretary was invited to attend. So I was looking at what we have done in this area, so that's why I was attending this meeting, this lecture. It was very fortunate attending. But what are the challenges and how are we going to solve this? Because we cannot look at disasters as a separate issue and also conserving our own heritage, not only this site, but there are other sites. What are the challenges?
What I have to say is the need to have a sort of integrated approach, because it has been seen as a hindrance to the urban development. We have even the disaster mitigation which has to be incorporated into a sort of a urban development plan. Even the heritage at a new dimension and new value to the urban development. So that we have to have a very integrated approach, incorporating heritage, disaster management, disaster mitigation. All that must be addressed in a very comprehensive and holistic manner without addressing separate pockets. So that what I mentioned is that even the disaster management should be a part of the urban development. It should actually incorporate in all the development plans. Because we can't take the disaster sort of preparedness in isolation. So it has to be even in conservation. You can't take conservation in isolation. So it has to be a part of the urban development. It adds a value and then give dimension to the entire development. So that some people see heritage as a hindrance, but it adds a value and it gives us identity and the belongings into a society. So that is why it has to be an integrated approach, a holistic approach, incorporating all these disciplines.
But of course, yes, we do use those buzzwords, integrated approaches. I mean, I'm not challenging your ideas, but what I'm saying is that what are the challenges exactly that we have today?
The challenges, as far as mentioned, because that I mentioned is that the required capacity and the skill craft is one of the challenges that we are facing. And the material, that timber, maybe even for the normal construction, you would find good timber. You have to import timber because in Japan they have historic forest reserve. They are reserved for only for conservation, but we don't have such facilities here. But material is one of the major things. Unless you have the good timber for the conservation work, and material and manpower are the two the ingredients of the conservation, and the knowledge, and the sort of technology. Those are the things that we have to seriously consider and focus on, and ensure the sustainability of the technology and the materials.
And I think above all is the lack of knowledge of the planners, because you know, most of the urban heritage, the historic urban sites, historic routes are destroyed by the planning of the highways, and widening of the roads and all. So that has to be started from that point.
And also the digital documentation now, I mean, it's very interesting, because we also wanted to develop, I mean, when it comes to tsunami, I remember we developed a digital elevation model of how the entire Galle will be inundated in another tsunami or storm surge. So that type of...
Yes, sir, you have done some simulation studies, yes, and proposed some mitigation measures. As far as the disaster management is concerned, we have conducted but our mitigation measures. Unless we have the real analysis of the causes, we won't be able to develop a real plan for mitigation. So the simulation is one of the strategies that we use in order to understand what the impacts are and how we can mitigate those impacts.
Sir, thank you for your presentation. I have a question regarding the aspect of intangible cultural heritage, which you place so much emphasis on. So from a conservation point of view, what are the steps that should be taken in order to actually preserve this intangible cultural heritage? Because if you take a place like the Galle Fort, the first two things that come to mind are gems and the culinary aspect of it. But apart from that, what about things like language and the spoken language that is actually diminishing now, more towards a more commercial approach, I would say? What are your thoughts on that?
Because we have to consider both the human and intangible aspect. Because when I was studying in the crop, There was a thesis written by a Zimbabwe student. He said that it's your monument. I was right. The Galle one is the intangible aspect, not the tangible aspect. Because when a foreigner comes, he sees only the tangible thing. He may not perceive the intangible aspect of the culture. So, as a local, we perceive the intangible culture aspect. So that even in old world, when you consider the land form of the house form is determined by several factors, the material, technology, then the social cultural context. But most dominant factor which determines the forms of building the social cultural context. Even these houses were formed due to the social cultural context prevailing at that period. So unless we preserve these buildings reflect the social cultural context that existed at the time of creation of this field. So that we have to preserve the image of tangible culture as well as intangible. So then only get the real feeling of the presence of heritage.
But can you do that? You know,
that's the another problem. Because social cultural context is not studied. Or social cultural context is fast moving.
Yeah.
If the structure doesn't respond to the evolving social cultural context,
but let's say currently the land that they have bought, what is the status of that? If they are selling to some, they can sell it to another foreigner.
Yes.
Because they have already bought.
Yes, absolutely ownership. Nobody can ever
restrict. So the government can't give it back.
No, no, no. There's no problem. The government has a policy, I don't know. So we have to do some policies in order to get it back. See if it works or not. It's a position that should be taken by the government. And the government is going to liberalize everything or see not.
Yeah, because if you sort of make a policy that they can't sell outside, that if they sell, they have to sell to within the thing, then over a period of maybe 50 or 60 years, you might be able to get back the property.
Maybe if you don't have lease, instead of giving the ownership, the policy in the position.
Yeah.
It's a position that should be taken.
Because actually that is in keeping with what the original declaration of the heritage site.
Then it's also the same thing that there will be to conservation of national thousands of people. And most of them are companies, other companies. 1% is 1% shares. So 99 is of foreigners. But direction is all right. Any other questions, please?
Okay, thank you very much for your position.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much for enlightening the audience, and I wish to thank the audience for participating in this event, and it's a great encouragement for us. And we hope to see you in the next lecture also, in a month's time. Yes, now it's after this session. So in the next lecture, again we have in another lecture next month almost around this time. So I hope you all be part of it with more. And then we have a small refreshment for you. Please enjoy with us. Thank you.
Now we